Thank you. jokey.
Or maybe, but I don't think it does.
Maybe they try to figure out the new people. You know, like who's here that's new.
You know, they do. I think one of the things they do is
they say my name.
Sing a little choir.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And happy, hallelujah, and happy Lent to you all. We begin our season of Lent a little bit differently this year. Unfortunately, we weren't able to do it on Wednesday with Ash Wednesday. But you know what? After I slipped and slid on the ice coming back, I didn't think anybody else wanted to do that. So I thought we just start Lent today. So happy to see all of you this morning. Hope you are doing well and this week was fulfilling for you. I do have a couple announcements before we get started this morning. Make sure you sign the red welcome folder so we know you're here, all that good stuff. Because we are now officially in Lent, this coming Wednesday we are beginning our Lenten evening study. I've been trying to pass out the books to all those who requested one. But we're, you know, if you didn't sign up and would still like to attend, you're more than welcome to. The plan this week is to have a little supper at 6:30. I will make it. I'm hoping to make some chicken noodle soup and some things like that. If not, if I don't get that done, I'll just order Jimmy John's or something like that. Something quick. And then we'll have our study at 7. We'll be down in Fellowship Hall. So if you want to come around the back, I'll make sure to have the doors open for that. And if you could read the first chapter, we'll cover that on Wednesday. And then this Saturday, we have men's ministry. It's the beginning of the month. February's done already. Can you believe it? So Saturday at 9 a.m., we will have men's ministry out in the Fellowship Hall. Still doing BYOB, bring your own breakfast. So if you want to join us, the men, all men of the church are welcome. We have a good time of fellowship, food, and laughs, of course. I do have one prayer request before I turn it over to her. Kathleen Hammond is requesting prayers. She's going to have some surgery on her hand on Tuesday, so pray that the surgery goes well. You've had a lot of surgeries, Kathleen, so hopefully this one will go quick, right?
I need my own wing.
And then she also has an announcement herself. All right. Are there any other announcements that anybody would like to share? Well, if there are none, I invite you to rise as you are able and let us greet one another in the peace and love of our Lord Jesus Christ. We begin our worship this morning with a choral call to worship. The first verse of Again We Keep This Solemn Fast, and that will lead right into, I'm assuming, right? Lord Jesus, who through 40 days. So let us worship God in song. The Lenten season is a time for prayer and reflection, for refocusing our hearts and minds on Christ. May we turn away from the darkness in our lives and, trusting in God's mercy, confess our sins before God and one another. Let us pray. Almighty God, we confess to you and to one another that we have sinned by our own fault in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. We pray this through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. This saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
I invite any young or young at heart to join me up front. Good morning, everyone. Good to see you. Did everybody have a good week? Good. Wonderful. Come on, Maddie. Susie's not here again today, just so you know, if you can tell. And to answer the question before you ask, I don't know where she is. I'm assuming she's at home, but I don't know. Okay? All right. Thank you. So I have this weird thing. What do you think this is?
A paper bag.
It's a paper bag. What do you think paper bag like a paper bag like this holds?
A birthday present.
A birthday present or what else? A what?
Puzzle.
A puzzle? Okay. It could. What? A puzzle? What do you call, like if it's a puzzle and you're going to give this to somebody, what's a word that starts with a G that it could be? Yeah? Gift. All right. Very good. We give, this is a gift. I'll spoil it for you. There's nothing in there. I'm just using it as an image. So don't expect that you're getting anything. I'm sorry. But who likes to receive gifts? Anybody? Yeah, you like to just receive gifts? Aren't gifts fun? What's the best gift that you've ever gotten?
Jesus.
All right, good. We're moving in good ways. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. What else has anybody gotten as a good gift?
CDs.
A DVD?
DVD.
DVD, yeah. Anybody else? Did you ever get a gift?
Shoes.
Shoes? Yeah. Those are really good. I like good shoes, yeah. Snow boots, yeah, yeah. Anybody else get a good gift? Yeah,
a stuffed animal.
A stuffed animal, yeah. I think we all like to get good gifts, right? That's why I think we like Christmas time. We like our birthdays because it's always nice to get good gifts. Well, you know what also is or should be fun is giving gifts. How often do you give gifts? Anybody?
At my friend's birthday.
It's your friend's birthday. Good, yeah. And what? You need money to give gifts. That's true. You can make them. You can make them out of like paper or something. Yeah. But the important. But as much as it's nice to receive a gift, it's just as important to give a gift. Well, we give gifts to our friends, to our family, but you know who else would like a gift? Jesus, yeah. So what do you think are kind of gifts that Jesus might like? Yeah?
Being kind to people.
That is a wonderful gift
getting
that
baptized.
I think Jesus... Getting baptized, that's a wonderful gift I think that Jesus would really like to receive. Good. Yes, Kendrick?
Us.
Us, yeah, yeah. Aubriella?
Love.
Love, yeah. These kids are so smart. You went right to the point. That's exactly what we're going to talk about in our sermon today. When we're going to talk about sacrifices, which is a little bit of a weird thing to us. But the point of the sacrifices in the ancient world was to give gifts to God, and it wasn't necessarily the idea behind it
or it wasn't the thing that God wanted, but it was our love, our devotion, our faith, our attention. Those are the things that God really loves, and those are the gifts we can give to God. So what do you think you can do this week to give God your love or your attention or yourself? Yeah, Rick? You can pray. Very good. Anything else? Uh-huh. Good. Be kind. Good.
Spend time reading the Bible, whether it's online or in real life.
Good. Yep. Spend time reading the Bible. Exactly. It's about giving back your love. That's the gift that Jesus would love. All right? So that's what I encourage you to do this week, is give Jesus the gift of your love and your time. All right? So let's pray, and you can head down to Sunday school. Oh, Jesus, we thank you for all that you have done for us. In return, may we give you the gift of our love and our time, the gift of ourselves. Amen. All right. Thank you.
We do bring our prayers.
Thank you, choir. For our scripture reading this morning, we are going to take an interesting road through the book of Leviticus. Don't everybody express your excitement all at once, okay? We're going to read the first chapter, which is verses 1 through 17. And if you're following along in one of the Pew Bibles, it is on page 71. Listen for what the Spirit has to say to us this morning. The Lord called to Moses and spoke to him from the tent of meeting. He said, "Speak to the Israelites and say to them, 'When any of you brings an offering to the Lord, bring as your offering an animal from either the herd or the flock. If the offering is a burnt offering from the herd, he is to offer a male without defect. He must present it at the entrance to the tent of meeting, so that it will be acceptable to the Lord. He is to lay his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it will be accepted on his behalf to make atonement for him. He is to slaughter the young bull before the Lord, and then Aaron's sons, the priests, shall bring the blood and sprinkle it against the altar on all sides at the entrance to the tent of meeting. He is to skin the burnt offering and cut it into pieces. The sons of Aaron the priest are to put fire on the altar and arrange wood on the fire. Then Aaron's sons, the priests, shall arrange the pieces, including the head and the fat, on the burning wood that is on the altar. He is to wash the inner parts and the legs with water, and the priest is to burn all of it on the altar. It is a burnt offering, an offering made by fire, an aroma pleasing to the Lord. If the offering is a burnt offering from the flock, from either the sheep or the goats, he is to offer a male without defect. He is to slaughter it at the north side of the altar before the Lord, and Aaron's sons, the priests, shall sprinkle its blood against the altar on all sides. He is to cut it into pieces, and the priest shall arrange them, including the head and the fat, on the burning wood that is on the altar. He is to wash the inner parts and the legs with water, and the priest is to bring all of it and burn it on the altar. It is a burnt offering, an offering made by fire, an aroma pleasing to the Lord. If the offering to the Lord is a burnt offering of birds, he is to offer a dove or a young pigeon. The priest shall bring it to the altar, wring off the head, and burn it on the altar. Its blood shall be drained out on the side of the altar. He is to remove the crop with its contents and throw it to the east side of the altar where the ashes are. He shall tear it open by the wings, not severing it completely, and then the priest shall burn it on the wood that is on the fire on the altar. It is a burnt offering, an offering made by fire, an aroma pleasing to the Lord." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. So how did you get ready this morning to come to church? What activities are necessary for getting ready to go to church or to work or to school or really anywhere? Well, at the very least, I hope that you got dressed. But maybe before you got dressed, you, of course, have to get out of bed. And then you have to locate the clothes that you're going to wear, right? Perhaps in between getting out of bed and putting on your clothes, you took a shower or a bath to make sure that you were clean. How did you take your shower? Did you make sure you washed your head and your body and your face and your hands and all that? Did you eat breakfast after you got dressed? Did you make sure you grabbed your keys? Maybe your lunch or your lunch money or your wallet or your purse? Although some of these things can be done in various order, all of us have a morning routine, right? Maybe some of us drink some coffee. Maybe some of us go for a run. I don't know. Now, the parts of our morning routine are shaped by society. Like, we have to wear clothes if we're going to go out. And if you don't, you're probably going to be arrested. Some are more personal choices, like maybe watching the morning news, or reading your daily devotions. However they came to be, our lives are so shaped by routines and habits that sometimes we don't even realize it. But yet these routines and habits help us achieve the best life that we can do. And in many ways, I think our daily routines can help us connect and understand the significance of the sacrifices found here in the book of Leviticus. The sacrifices were rituals. And a ritual is a system of activities for a particular purpose. Whether we recognize them or not, we as human beings act out many rituals, many systems of activities for a particular purpose, however mundane they may be, whether that's drinking coffee or getting ready in the morning. We do them on a daily basis. Now, before we get too far, I do want to back up and introduce us to the book of Leviticus. Yes, we are going for Lent this year. We are going to do certain chapters of Leviticus. And I remember Isabel Taylor telling me about a month or so ago, I was very brave or crazy. I can't remember the word you chose for doing Leviticus during Lent. But here we are. I have chosen to do this. If you've ever read through the whole Bible, well, you probably start at the beginning, would be my guess. And if you do, as you read through Genesis and Exodus, you find that they're exciting books full of interesting characters and intense action. And then there's Leviticus, the place where Bible reading plans go to die. Leviticus is filled with unusual rituals and laws that, in all honesty, we don't understand. We are several thousand years removed from them, and we honestly don't know what to do with them. But I will argue that Leviticus is a necessary part to understand God's story of redeeming humanity. And yes, I would argue at least once everybody should read the book of Leviticus, as exciting as it may be. For you see, Genesis tells us how we were wonderfully and lovingly made by God. But then things got a little messy. But God did not leave us on our own, but rather chose to work through a man named Abraham and his descendants. The book of Exodus showed us how God saved Abraham's descendants from slavery and made them his people, made a covenant with them, made a relationship with them. But the Israelites struggled with obeying God's commands with this thing that we call sin. And so Leviticus answers the question of how God is going to relate to a sinful and usually disobedient people. And I'm going to try to convince you over the next 6 weeks that Leviticus is also a book for us today. The book reminds us how we often fall short of God's expectations. Yes. But Leviticus shows us how our God is merciful and figures out a way to redeem us and to atone for our sin. As we jump into the first chapter of Leviticus, it wastes no time and jumps right into instructions about sacrifices. Now, sacrifices and other rituals that used all kinds of materials and victims, which included, yes, animals and sometimes human beings. These kinds of rituals were an essential part of religious life for thousands of years all over the world, including ancient civilizations like Mesopotamia, Egypt, Syria, and Greece. And like others, the ancestors of the Israelites also practiced animal sacrifice. You can see them all the way through the book of Genesis and even Exodus. So this form of religious worship was not strange to them at all. Actually, when they were given these instructions, they probably thought, oh, okay, I guess we do it that way instead of this way. They probably thought nothing of it. However, for those of us living today, it's a totally different matter. Animal sacrifices are extremely foreign and quite repulsive to us. So how in the world can we begin to understand these acts of sacrifice and get anything out of it? Well, I'm going to try. And we're going to begin with looking at the process of the sacrifice. There are two key words in the first three verses of Leviticus chapter 1 that I think we really need to pay attention to that help set the scene. And those two words are when and if. So in verse 2, God says to Moses, when any of you brings an offering. And in verse 3, God says, if the offering is a burnt offering. These two words, when and if, indicate that these actions are voluntary. The Israelites can choose if and when to bring an offering to the Lord. Now we'll get into the why in a few moments. However, once the choice is made to offer a sacrifice, then yes, the instructions are set on how the activity is to be carried out by the priests, and yes, it gets a little graphic, but the choice is there. And so with the acceptable sacrifice in tow, the individual Israelite comes to the entrance of the tent of meeting or the tabernacle, the movable structure that ultimately would be the guide for the temple in Jerusalem. And they come to the outer altar, which is located just outside of the tent of meeting. And it is there where the priest goes through the ritual and performs the necessary actions, which have been dictated by God. Now, some of us are thinking, well, you know, why do we have to follow it in a specific way? Well, we too live in a world where certain things and actions are fixed, and they are also dictated by those above us. Take, for example, if you go to the bank and you want to withdraw some money from the ATM, well, you can't just do it any old way. You have to follow the steps that the bank sets forth. If you fail to insert your debit card, enter your PIN number, select the account from which you want to withdraw, select the amount you want to withdraw, etc., etc. If you don't do that specific process in the specific way, it will not work, and you will not get your cash. Well, in a similar way, God is concerned with the procedure in which the burnt offering is done, as well as its result. However, the goal is the most important part. But what is the goal of a sacrifice? Well, from one point of view, the burning of an offering, the burning of an animal, the sacrifice of an animal is really wasteful, because valuable meat that people could eat and receive nutrients from is ultimately burned to ash and is dumped outside the camp where the Israelites stayed. So on an outsider view, it seems very wasteful. One benefit that is mentioned later on in chapter 6 is that chapter 7, is that the priests who perform the sacrifice are able to keep a portion of it for their own consumption. So that's nice. They get to be fed. But food for the priests can't be the only goal of a sacrifice, can it? Well, the true purpose of a sacrifice isn't an ordinary one, nor is it something that we can physically see. Verses 9, 13, and 17 tell us what the overall goal of the offerings, of at least the burnt offerings of sacrifices, are to be. They are to be a gift of pleasing aroma to the Lord. But why would God need this kind of gift? Well, I think an answer can come if we look at a parallel act from another ancient civilization. In an ancient Babylonian epic, a man by the name of Atrahasis offered a burnt sacrifice to his gods after the flood, like the flood that we talk about in Noah in Genesis 7 through 8. It's interesting that a lot of ancient civilizations have a flood story, but that's for another day. When Atrahasis offered his sacrifice in the epic, the gods flocked to the burnt meat because they were starving as a result of the flood. You see, in the ancient Babylonians' understanding, the sacrifices that humans made fed the gods. The gods would literally eat the sacrifices. And so, in a kind of a maybe not well thought out process, if there were no humans to make sacrifices because they were wiped out in the flood, that means the gods could not be fed. However, we read in the Hebrew and Christian scriptures that unlike the gods of ancient Babylon, the God of Israel does not need human food. Now, while God does not need it, he can accept the gift of food. On one occasion, Abraham gave God a whole meal. Back in Genesis chapter 18, when the Lord appeared to Abraham as a traveler with two companions, Abraham quickly moved and asked his wife Sarah to make bread cakes. And then Abraham himself sacrificed a calf to provide meat. And then he set the food before the three men, and along with milk and curds, they had a grand feast. So just as Abraham showed his friendship by offering God a meal, the Israelites, through their sacrifice, demonstrate their desire for a good relationship with God, and they offer him food gifts. But this action is more than just simple hospitality. To offer a sacrifice, to go through all this ritual, to go through all this process, is all to interact with God. The sacrifices and offerings that they provided and gave were a bridging mechanism in which this mortal flesh and blood that we are a part of can interact in an unseeable way with an internal and unseen being. It's through their offerings that the Israelites came to the sanctuary, and they were able to give something tangible, something they could see and touch to God, who they can't see, who they can't touch. And all of this was to express their devotion, to express their thanks, or to seek forgiveness. And in response to the worshiper's actions, God says that he takes pleasure in it. Now, this doesn't mean, I don't think, that God literally enjoyed the smell of burning animals. If you've ever smelled actual burning flesh, it is an obnoxious stench. But what actually pleased God was the love and the faith that the person expressed through their sacrifice. It was a gift to God. I remember a time when I was younger. I don't remember how old I was, but I remember it was my mom's birthday. And I thought I wanted to give her a gift. And so with the little spending money that I had saved up, my grandma took me shopping. And I decided to give my mom a colander for her birthday. I don't know why I chose a colander, because my mom already had one. It was plastic and it was orange. I remember that. I don't know why. But I decided I wanted to give her a better colander. It was a metal one. And I was just so excited to give it to her. Yes, it cost me something. It cost me some of my money that I had earned up and saved up. I could have used that money for myself. I could have bought video games or food or something that I would have enjoyed as a kid. But rather, I used my resources to express my love for my mom in response to the love that my mom has already given me. The gift didn't buy my mom's love. My mom already loved me. So that's not the purpose of the gift. Rather, my gift expressed my gratitude for all that my mom had already done. And so that's kind of the thought of sacrifices. They were gifts to God to express the worshiper's love. As Christians, we are no longer required to provide animal sacrifices. According to the New Testament, the sacrificial system was completely fulfilled in the wonderful and awesome sacrifice of Christ, who himself is God's gift to us, to all of humanity, whom John the Baptist introduced as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And so it's interesting that now, you know, we had this whole process, but animal sacrifices are no longer needed to interact with God, nor are they needed to be the vessel through which God provides his pleasure or grace. Instead, rather, now that is done through the person, the work and person of Christ. But before I get too far, we'll pause there on that thought, because we'll get to that topic about Christ's sacrifice in another sermon later on in Lent. Now, while we as Christians no longer are required to offer sacrifices to God to express to him our love and faith, we still participate in rituals that express our love and faith. The two major rituals that we do within the church today are, can anybody guess what they are? Communion and baptism. Oh, well, George already put it up, didn't you? You know what? That's on me. I put it down that you were supposed to change it. Anyway, both of these rituals, communion and baptism, they express our attitude of love, and they express praise to God, and there are ways in which we can interact with God. When we take the bread and the cup, we can taste and see the goodness and grace in Jesus. When the waters of baptism wash over our skin, we can feel the cleansing power in Jesus, and we can connect with his death and resurrection. These rituals still are like the old, in which they can transcend the boundaries between mere flesh and blood and the divine. And just like the sacrifices that the ancient Israelites did, Holy Communion and baptism, at least to those who are on the outside, seem foolish and irrational and wasteful. But to those of us who believe, who understand it, they are incredibly powerful connections to God. There has been some pushback to the power of rituals in recent years. One such ritual that has been very critiqued and has seen very a decline in is that of weddings. Studies are showing that a rising number of young adults are choosing to live together and not get married. Now, 2021 and 2022 did see a slight rise in the performing of weddings, but that was probably due because they were postponed in 2020 because of the COVID pandemic. But the U.S. Census Bureau has reported that 34% of people ages 15 and over have never been married, which is up 23% from 1950, and it's rising. Now, while the cost of weddings are probably a big factor, many are seeing weddings as wasteful symbolism that are unnecessary, that aren't good ways to express love and commitment, and therefore are being pushed to the side and considered unimportant. Rituals like this are symbolic, and maybe there is some good critique in there that some weddings have become so big and so costful that maybe we need to reevaluate that. But I think that rituals like this are still wonderful ways to express one's love and devotion and commitment in a tangible way. Yes, there are other ways to do it, but there's something powerful about getting up in front of your friends and family and expressing your love and commitment for one another. While we are not obligated to do so, other rituals and traditions that we do, like funerals, or holidays, such as Christmas, or Thanksgiving, or Easter, these are still ways in which, yes, we do things specifically, and to the outsider seem like unnecessary wastes of time. But these rituals are still wonderful ways that allow us to express ourselves. They're wonderful ways to create community. They're wonderful ways to make memories. They're wonderful ways to celebrate. They're wonderful ways to remember what God has done and connect to Him. While we don't have to make animal sacrifices anymore, we still participate in many rituals here in the church. Guess what? You're participating in a ritual right now. Gathering on Sunday mornings is a ritual. Yes. They're symbolic. They're hard to kind of grasp and see why we do them. But to us, they are real and they're important because they make what can't be seen seeable. And they make what can't be touched touchable. They have the power to do things that other kind of activity just can't do. Somehow, some way, maybe beyond our understanding, they bridge the gap between us and God. At least until that day when we can stand face to face to God and enjoy that fellowship, communion, and connection forever and ever. But we're not to that day yet. On that day, rituals like this won't be needed because we'll be in God's presence. But for now, our Christian rituals, like communion, like baptism, like Sunday worship, they help us experience God here and now. And that's what we're all doing. Experiencing and connecting and being in a relationship with God. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we are thankful for all that you have done for your people throughout history. We are thankful that you are able to interact and provide grace through sacrifices. We are extremely thankful for your Son, the ultimate gift to us, that through him we know you, and it is through his shedding of his blood that we find forgiveness and mercy. In return to the wonderful love and gifts that you have given us, we try to express our devotion to you through our commitment to our church and through the service of others. May we love you as you have dearly loved us. Father, as we begin this season of Lent, help us empty ourselves of characteristics and habits that keep us from becoming more like Jesus. We ask that you make this Lent a season where we find our way out of darkness and find our way back to you. Help us to be true in the devotion that we give to you in this season and always. Father, we lift to you the names of our friends and family and neighbors that are hurting, who are grieving, who are sick, who need your strong arm. We pray for Ralph Hawkins, for Molly McCoy, for Jim Lemons, and for Kathleen Hammond. Remind them and remind us as well that you never promised us a life without grief or pain or sickness. But you do promise to stand with us when we hurt. You promise to heal our hearts when they break. And so we ask that we feel your loving and healing presence again today, tomorrow, and always. We also raise to you our celebrations and joys. Help us to see the blessings that are in our lives. And help us find more opportunities to experience the joys that you provide. Father, we also raise to you the prayers deep in our hearts and minds. The prayers that perhaps we've never spoken to anyone else. But we trust that you know and understand. Father, we raise all of these prayers to you in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In response to the gifts that you have given back to the church because of the gifts that God has given us, would you please rise as you're able and let us join together in our doxology. Let us join together in our prayer of dedication.
O God, we proclaim our gratitude for all our blessings. As we embrace the season of fasting and reflection, help us recognize the best of our treasures and share them with you and with each other. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us join together in our hymn, Near the Cross.
Breathe through all our evil streams.
May that be what we do this Lent. May we stay near the cross of Christ, the Lamb of God, who comes to take the sins away that we commit. And may we go forth from this place to show our love and devotion to our God in all that we do. And as we do so, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Go in peace. Amen.